Hey guys, thanks for coming.
First time doing one of these, so very excited.
I wanted to tell you a little bit about myself and who I am and how I got here. I know a lot of you know who I am. There's a few of you who don't, so I'll speak to you guys. I started as a personal trainer. I was pretty active as a kid. Went into kin, kind of like the normal progression that us fitness guys go into. Started as a personal trainer. I was in Ottawa at the time, working with a lot of execs and CEOs. A lot of them had back pain. A lot of them wine and dine with their clients and stuff like that. And so it was a lot of, they wanted a good workout, they didn't want to be in pain, and they wanted to golf. Right? That was my clientele. And I think I was pretty good at it. And then I went into fascial stretch therapy. So I got into the rehab aspect of it. Started doing fascial stretch therapy and neurosomatic, trigger point release, working with chronic pain. And then I kind of got bored of that and I started to move into the nutrition aspect. Wellness, lifestyle coaching, the biggest part. I found that when you're coaching people and working with people, it's less about how much vitamin A, vitamin B, vitamin C they need, and more about the lifestyle habits that they have to work on in order to live a healthy life that they want, right? So today's seminar is going to be a little bit of a broad overview around gut health and things that happen on a physiological level, but I really want to talk about some of the major lifestyle habits and overall ideas in terms of supplementation that can really help you if you have issues, okay? Enough about me, so you guys came here. So for the few of you that I don't know, any of you guys want to share why you're here, what's going on, so we can kind of tailor this to you, because you guys are who's here. Anyone want to go first? What do you want to lose?
Belly fat.
Lose belly fat.
I sit most of the time for the day.
Yeah.
In front of a computer.
Okay.
So you get neck pain.
Yeah.
You build it here on the hips.
Okay, so what do you think the biggest issue with you having belly fat is? Like, why you're not losing it? What do you think you need the most?
Eating incorrectly.
So you need help with, what to eat?
Yes.
Is it what to eat, or is it the habit of just eating poorly? Do you know what you should be eating? And you choose not to?
Kind of.
Okay.
But.
Right, motivation can be part of it.
Yeah.
Right, having a team or accountability. Right, it's all part of it, right? I know exactly what I should be. I just had Skittles in my mouth. Again, it's choices, right, that we make daily. Anyone else? No.
Whatever you
want to
talk about.
Whatever I want to talk about.
Yeah, I love to learn.
You love to learn? Okay, what do you want to learn about?
Anything. I'm all into anatomy, physiology, okay. Nutrition.
Are you a trainer?
No, I'm not.
Okay, so you're just going to learn.
I did go to school for kinesiology, but.
Okay.
In the health and wellness industries.
Okay. Do you have any symptomology you're trying to figure out, or do you feel pretty good?
I feel pretty good.
Okay, so why are you here? What do you want to learn?
Well, Chad actually told me about gut health.
Yeah.
So I'm into looking more into that. So okay. I just recently started going vegan, so I don't know if you're going to talk about anything with that, with nutrition.
Okay. Yeah, I'll go over a few things.
Okay, cool.
Chad, what are you here? What do you want to
learn? I'm here to work with people who are interested in weight loss, specifically fat loss.
Yeah.
And a lot of them come to me with gut health issues, and I want to understand how I can better assess them.
Okay.
And then help them out.
Okay, cool. What's your nutrition background? Do you have one at all?
No, not really. No, I just work with Joe. All my certification stuff's with Joe.
Okay, cool. Tanya?
I don't know. I have still clients, I'm still personal training.
Yes.
I just got picked up in the summer as an amateur boxer, so I'm boxing all the time now.
Nice.
And I eat so much food, but I'm so sick and tired of what I eat, so I think I want to make sure I'm using the food that I'm eating properly.
How's your body feeling?
Pretty good.
Okay, so what's pretty good mean? So this is something I want to get clear, right? Everyone's like, oh, I feel pretty good, I feel okay. What does that mean? Right? Right? Like, if you go to the doctor and you do a blood panel, right, and you're okay, right, I'm healthy. That's what people say, I'm healthy. What does that mean? Does it really mean you're healthy? Or does it just mean you don't have a disease, you're not sick, you're not in a disease state?
I think that's the side of it that people think about more. You're not in a disease, so you're healthy.
Yeah, and unfortunately, especially here in Ontario, right, we're in that situation where all you have is a doctor, right, and they're gonna assess whether you're sick or dying. And then you're only on the offer as a naturopath, and people don't even think to really go to a naturopath.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And at the other point, the naturopath isn't really a coach. And so they go and you can go to them and you get a list of supplementation, or you have your half-hour appointment or whatever it is, and then that person goes home and they do what they're supposed to do, maybe for a week, right? And so what I'm really trying to do is educate trainers how to be that kind of health coach in a way, right? Because a lot of it is just lifestyle and habitual stuff. Makes sense? Okay. Symptoms. Okay, so I want to go over this. So let's start with, you know, people come to us, a few of us are trainers, and people have symptoms, right? So what are some of the symptoms that people feel? Headaches.
Low energy.
Yeah.
Low energy.
Can't sleep.
Bloating.
Bloating. What else?
I think we struggle to eat.
Say again?
We struggle to eat.
Struggle to eat, like no appetite.
Yeah.
What else?
Dizziness.
Okay.
Pretty often. Essentially, can we, I don't want to say use the words reverse, but can we remove symptomology that you get from arthritis based on lifestyle habits, right? And so that's what we want to focus on, right? We can remove a lot of inflammation that people have these like, oh, I went to the doctor and they said I have arthritis in my joints. Well, yeah, if you don't move and eat poorly, right, synovial fluid isn't moving around the joints, you get build up, and then you get some joint pain, right? Okay, how many of you in here, if you were to pinch your belly fat right now, does it hurt? Kind of
sensitive, right?
That's like inflammation, right? Roland's got nothing. He's good.
I was one of the Jason Prasad fans, man. Talking about today,
right? Yeah, that's inflammation, right? And when your body's inflamed, it gets harder and harder to burn fat, right? When you're inflamed, you almost have like a concrete wall you're trying to break down versus drywall. Okay, so that's why when you don't sleep, when you eat poorly. When you drink coffee all day, it doesn't matter when you go to the gym because the body's inflamed. It's already on fire. It doesn't really care about losing weight at that point. Building muscle, burning fat, right? It's in fight or flight, okay? So all of these are symptoms. Where do symptoms come from? What causes symptoms?
Your body's way of telling you something's wrong.
Okay, right? What do most people do?
Deal
with the symptom. I have a headache. What do people do?
Take an Advil.
Roland, how good is Advil for your stomach?
Oh, it's amazing.
Yeah. It's amazing, right? So, no, Advil is not good for your stomach, okay? Not good. Right? Drinking water is probably the first step, right? If you're thirsty, what symptom will your body tell you you are? Does anybody know? Usually it tells you
you're thirsty.
Well, usually you are hungry before you're thirsty. So the first symptom is hunger. If you feel thirsty, you are very dehydrated. That's the message, okay? Skin, what does skin do for the body?
Protects you,
it's a defense organ. What else does it do?
Sweats.
Yeah, so detoxifies, okay? So acne, pimples, eczema, rashes, What are they? A symptom of what?
Toxins.
Right? Toxins, immune reactions, something in the body, right? It's your skin is telling you what's going on with your organ health, right? It's telling you if you're consuming, what you're consuming is good for your body or not. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so now we're going to go down this little graph. All right.
Does anyone here have skin problems?
Yeah.
I do.
You do?
Yeah.
What do you have?
Psoriasis.
Psoriasis. Ooh.
Elbows and knees.
How do you feel when you drink beer?
Beer?
Yeah.
I don't ever drink beer.
You don't ever drink beer?
Like, I would say, like, maybe once every 2 years.
Is that because it bothers you?
No, I'm like a man.
Okay.
All right,
fair enough.
I'm gonna test it out. You see that? See how I feel. Loaded, probably. You see that?
I get the hormonal acne on, like, my chin.
Hormonal acne on your chin? Okay. Do you chin? Is there a saying? Your chin?
Yeah. Yeah, all the time.
Anyone else?
Yeah, same with the
30-year-old
having
breakouts. Birth control?
IUD. Mm-hmm.
How many of you have been on birth control?
I have IUD, so it's
progesterone,
something like that.
Copper?
Mm-hmm. The
progesterone one. Progesterone, okay. Right. So essentially, you have hormones releasing inside of your
yeah,
body.
All the time.
Just want to clarify that part.
Yeah.
Okay, so we talked about skin. Now, the biggest thing for me is skin always tells me what's going on in the gut. Right, always. Now, based on what's happening on the skin can give you an idea as to what is actually going on inside of the stomach, right? Oftentimes, in terms of the skin, right, we said we saw acne, rashes, you mentioned psoriasis, eczema, so, if we know that all of this is coming from the gut, does anyone know anything that you could be doing to cause this to yourself?
Food you intake?
Food. Yeah, right? So a lot of this comes from food, right? And so then if we talk about, you know, food, what does food do for us?
Fuels us?
Fuels you, right? Fuel. But what if this fuel tells your body to not absorb it and just spit it out? And has anyone ever heard of food intolerances?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, have you guys heard of food intolerances?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So what's your thought on food intolerances? What do you know about it?
Your body just doesn't react well with certain foods. Okay, it causes issues.
Okay. Symptoms. Do you know how or what system fights it?
No.
Anyone else?
Mm-hmm.
You're immune, right? Okay, so food intolerances is your immune system fighting. What's happening is you're getting an IgG response. You're getting an IgG response. Okay, there's IgE, histamine reaction, and there's IgG, which is an antibody food response, okay? And when you eat these food particles get into your bloodstream based on digestion, your immune system starts to attack them, right? And then what happens is you get this immune reaction and you can get congestion, you get headaches, brain fog, you get all those symptoms that we talked about, okay? Now, unfortunately, if this continues long enough, you get multiple reactions to food, and our immune system starts to get weak, right? As this progresses, months after months, right, years, how many of you have had something that you just can't eat for, like, years? No? Yeah, right? Okay. That's based on something called leaky gut. We're going to get into that after. But we got multiple reactions. Our immune system starts to down-regulate. Right? We get more and more sick. We always feel like we're fighting something. Right? We're on that edge, right? You just feel like there's a rain cloud over you all the time. Okay? And then from there, what happens is we start to get what we call autoimmune diseases. Has anyone ever heard of autoimmune diseases?
Mm-hmm.
Right? Colitis is technically autoimmune disease. Right? IBS is kind of one of the first signs. Then you can progress into things like Crohn's. Right? Basically, your immune system is attacking yourself. And it's making you sick. And therefore, in the Western medical system, you start to get into chemo and things like that to actually stop your immune system from fighting it. right? And then how do you think your health progresses? Down there. Okay. So what do we want to do essentially? We started with some skin issues and we figure out the progression if it continues. So what do we need to do?
Identify
our food tolerances. Identify food tolerances, right? So that's step number one. I need a bigger whiteboard next time, guys.
Sorry. That one's very small.
Yeah, whiteboards are expensive. Okay, so food intolerances. Okay, does anyone know the different ways to figure out food intolerances? Yeah, so there's blood testing, IgG blood testing. A lot of naturopaths offer that. Is 23andMe good? No, they're just genetics.
It's just the base.
There's blood testing you can do for that. Depending on your naturopath, there's different food lists that you can do. There's also the other method that I use, which is a biomarine machine. It's a biofeedback machine, so it's a little bit more sensitive. You can test, in my opinion, I can test more foods, right? Every food or item on this planet has a certain frequency that it vibrates at, right? And if you get into energetics or anything like that, certain people that we vibe with, so to speak, you know, there's just that feeling, there's other people that we don't. Same thing for food, right? Our food can vibrate at a frequency that can either harm us or help us. And now when our health, right, our frequency that we vibrate on starts to come down regularly because we're getting sick, more and more foods we don't react to. And so what's the purpose? The purpose is to now remove the foods that are harming us so we can fix our health, stop the immune reaction, heal our gut, and then we can retest or try the foods again, do some sort of food rotation, and figure out what foods are bothering us or not. Okay? But the biggest thing for me, just identifying what it is. If you really want to like get your health kind of fast-tracked to get better, you have to remove what's hurting you, which is your food intolerances. Right? If you're eating food intolerances with a meal that's, say, good for you, so I'll give an example. I was intolerant to spinach, all lettuces, sweet potato, right? White potato did better for me, and avocado and oatmeal would give me instant diarrhea. So, right, these are staple foods, good foods that are supposed to be good for you, right? So it's food intolerances isn't bad food. But obviously, we shouldn't have bad food. Shouldn't have the Skittles that I had in the beginning, right? Shouldn't have that, right? But once you identify, now you're having good food, you have to also look, like if there's spinach in that green shake, I'm gonna feel it for sure. There is.
I should have worn tan pants,
right? You can see it. Right, so I'm intolerant to spinach. So and lettuce. So my salads are really arugula and kale. Right, I've had other people where they're intolerant to kale and lettuce. So they're kind of spinach based, right? We're gonna identify how this comes about, but it's identifying what foods bother us. So if I have a, I would go to the States. I'm intolerant to butter, and I would go to a steakhouse, order me a steak and vegetables. Right. By the time I finished my steak, I was on the toilet because they soak the steaks in butter. Right? And so my body didn't really digest any of that food I just ate. It just went right through me. So am I getting any nutrients now? No, my body still didn't eat, really. It still didn't get the nutrients. The food went through me. And so what does that tell you? It tells you how important bowel movements are. Right? If you have a good, solid bowel movement, your body is digesting food, your gut is doing what it has to do. Right? If you're not having good bowel movements, then your body's trying to tell you something. And you have to identify what it is. Right? Because if you want to lose 10 pounds, but all you have is diarrhea, guess what? And your body's not going to lose that 10 pounds. It's holding on to it because it's in fight or flight because it's not getting any nutrients. Right? And think of how many people have lived in that state for months, if not years. Right? That's why sometimes we look at people and we talk about like the look on their face, like their face comes back to life if they start drinking water. Right? How much water are you supposed to drink in a day? Does anyone know?
2 liters.
2 liters? Is that based on you?
No.
Everyone should just drink 2 liters.
It's half your body weight
in ounces. Yeah, good. Okay. Well, the other day. What's that? Sorry, you say that? No? Okay. Yeah, half your body weight in ounces one per day. Right, that's like a minimum, to be honest. Right, that's for human function. Right, you should consume that amount based on your body making, 72% water? Okay. So example, if you're 200 pounds, that is 100 ounces of water, which is just over 3 liters. Okay. Then if you're working out, right, Adelaide, what's your work conditions like? Are you inside? Are you outside? Are you sweating? Are you sitting on your butt? That kind of stuff.
I have a massive problem absorbing water. I put salt in my water. I try to take all these different kinds of water. And very few of them really like stay with me. Otherwise, like, I'll drink and just like go
so right
through. And I still feel dehydrated. I get headaches.
Can you put salt in your water?
Yeah.
But
it doesn't stick. I don't know what it is.
Is this the same issue you had when we worked here?
Yeah. I had it for so long.
I said salt. You have any other ideas?
It's your potassium intake,
like salt imbalance.
Could be one thing. Could be aldosterone. Could be a whole bunch of stuff. It's like a conversation we should have after you're done.
Perfect. Sounds good. Okay. All right. So for gut health, we identify food intolerances. Water. Do you think water affects your gut? Just overall organ function.
Yeah.
Right. So no matter who I work with, nobody drinks enough water. Nobody drinks enough water. I have one therapy client who his tissue is so rigid and hard. I said, I will not work on you for 3 weeks because I need you to give me 3 weeks of drinking water. Right? My mom's an example. Okay? She admits it. Right? If your tissue is so, like, think about it. If you don't give a plant water, what happens? It dries up and dies. But we do that to ourselves. We don't drink water, we keep drinking coffee, which dehydrates us even more. And we want to know why we're tired. We want to know why our brain doesn't function. Oh no, more coffee. That's going to help our brain function. No, when you're tired, your brain's not functioning, drink some water. It'll help you out. Okay? Now, if you're chronically dehydrated for years, do you think that will lead you to a disease state? Right? So when you're working with clients, like, this isn't rocket science. This is all very simple lifestyle habits.
The food intolerance is a little more complicated, water is the easy part.
Okay, what else do you think affects your body's ability to digest food?
Sleep.
Sleep. Okay, what time are we supposed to go to sleep at and wake up at? Body's natural circadian rhythm.
I think you're supposed to get 8 hours.
Yeah, 8 hours is what you're supposed to get. Anyone know the times? No? 10 to 6. 10
to 6.
Okay, 10 p.m. to 6 a.m. is our body's natural circadian rhythm when we should be going to sleep, right? We should wake up in the sun. Sun comes up at 6? Yeah. Right? Not everyone follows that because people's circadian rhythms are a lot of whack. Okay. What affects sleep? Actually, remember this. How do we get a good night's sleep? What's the best? What are some, okay, we're talking habits, right?
Complete darkness, complete blackout.
Complete blackout. Blackout. If you have a TV in your room, what should you do? Unplug it. Unplug it. Get rid of that red or blue light that you have. Okay. Blackout.
What about your cell phones?
Okay, it sounds like a cool room, right?
Yeah.
Cool room. Does anyone know the temperature?
16 degrees.
19. Yeah, like 68 Fahrenheit.
16 Fahrenheit?
No,
68
Celsius.
68
Fahrenheit. 68 Celsius. No, 68 Fahrenheit. 16
Celsius.
It's like 16 to 18 Celsius. That's what
it's supposed to be.
Okay, phones. What about phones?
Airplane mode.
Yeah, airplane mode. Why is that?
That light is always on, that buzzing you can get when you're sleeping.
Yeah, so the light, our skin is light sensitive. So when you have that big blue light, bright light in your face, you're telling your body that it's time to wake up, not time to be sleeping. Okay, so realistically, you should have your phone around you for probably about 30 minutes to an hour before you go to sleep. Right? All the lights should be, there's light, special lights you can buy to remove the blue light from the bulb. I have magnesium lamps, just crystal lamps, right, that I turn on at night, just helps my eyes too. Red lights. Right? Yeah, red lights are good. So,
you can get, depending on what kind of phone you have, there's the app that'll turn all the redness, or sorry, all the blue light off your phone after like 7 p.m. So that you're only looking at a red screen.
Oh, wow.
It helps.
Okay, cool. Do you know the name of that?
I can't remember what it is.
Oh, okay. That's cool. And then you talked about, what were you talking about?
Pardon?
No,
chat.
Yeah, you were talking about something else to do with light or something.
And then like that buzzing goes over your sleep, but you can buzz while you're obviously asleep, like it vibrate.
Oh yeah, so for sure it can make noise, but phones, again, it's frequency, right?
Yeah.
When you go to a cottage, how well do you sleep?
Yeah.
So good. Why? Because there's no technology, there's no frequencies, right? So you turning off your phone at night, you're an antenna, you pick up frequencies as well. Right? So as soon as you turn that off, now you don't have signals coming in while you're sleeping, your body can get a better night's sleep. When I go to New York City, I'm like vibrating. Right? Because there's just so much going on. I can't be there for very long. That's just a city I know I can't be in. Okay?
Black and white cool room phones, what else? What else can we do to get better sleep?
Clear your mind. How do you clear your mind?
Meditate.
Can meditate for sure. What else can you do? Bed is meant to sleep, right? So you shouldn't be working in your bed, you shouldn't be hanging out in your bed, right? As soon as you go into your room, your body knows, hey, time to go to sleep, right? I know that's hard, we all live in condos and stuff like that, but it's just having a space energetically that is meant for sleep, okay? There's one more thing. What else can you do to affect sleep? Are you going to sleep well? No, because your blood sugar is going to spike, right? And that can lead to a very uncomfortable sleep. Okay. Does anyone have questions about that? No? Anyone have any questions so far? Can't see this. The whole peeing situation. A lot of people have issues with their bladder, right? Does anyone know anatomically where your bladder sits? It's behind your pubic bone. Okay? Literally right behind your pubic bone. What's on top of it? Your intestines. Alright? What's like above the intestines? Stomach, liver, okay? What's usually in front of all of that? What does the fat do?
Puts pressure.
Puts pressure, right? Mm-hmm. You know, you don't have a bunch of weight there, so there's something going on as to why your body's not absorbing water, and it could be a bunch of reasons, as Roland mentioned,
yeah.
Right? So just figuring that out. But most people, if they got a lot of weight in front here, mm-hmm. and that pushes down on everything, right? Think of a pregnant lady. She got to pee all the time. Why? Because there's a baby sitting on her bladder,
yeah.
Right? If you had an extra 20 pounds for years, plus some nutritional or like salt issues, all of this stuff can now continue into why you're having issues with water. And why you have to like, you can't go through the whole night without like getting up to pee, right? But a lot of people just don't drink very much. So you go from drinking nothing to drinking water all the time, what's gonna happen? You're gonna be peeing all the time, right? Because your bladder isn't even used to holding that much liquid in it, okay? And most of our clients are in like, you know, 30s to 40s to 50s. They don't drink water for decades.
Mm-hmm.
And then you're getting them to drink 3-4 liters, like, body doesn't know what's going on. Body doesn't know what water is. Okay? Okay, any more questions? That's a good one.
Good.
No? Everyone else good with what we talked about so far?
Oh,
yeah.
Snoring.
Snoring.
That disturbs the other person. snoring.
Why are they snoring?
Mm-hmm.
Well, snoring can be a physical thing, right?
But it could be a health from overweight and that kind of thing.
Yeah, it all ties in together, right? Like usually it's like the weight on their, it's either muscle tension or weight.
Okay.
When I was bigger, I would scream loud, right? Because I had like 10 to 20 pounds of muscle strung to my chest. Like, body's forcing myself to breathe, right? The back of my tongue starts to fall back, soft palate doesn't work properly, right? All of this soft tissue work can be done to actually help things function properly so people don't snore. But a lot of it too is just the weight, right? How many people have 20, 30 pounds sitting on their chest when they're laying down, right? So health for sure, I mean, health ties into the physical aspect, right? Snoring for me is more of a physical thing, unless those muscles aren't working, in which case then it's a therapy aspect, which can be done. Anything else? No? Okay. So I want to talk about, are we good? Anyone need a pee break? Am I good?
Probably.
You need a pee break? Okay, pee break in 10 minutes, okay? Everyone good for that? Okay. I want to finish this. So, okay, we're going to talk about digestion. So, a lot of people have issues with digestion. What symptoms do they get? Bloating. Indigestion. So that's got this food repeating, right? Mm-hmm. Ingestion. Burping. What else?
Constipation.
Mm-hmm. What else? Diarrhea. Mm-hmm. Right? Gassiness. Bloating.
Nausea.
Heartburn.
Okay.
All the things. Okay. Yeah, so let's talk about that, right? Right? Heartburn. People talk about Pepto-Bismol, right? Doctors put people on proton pump. Does anyone know, everyone know what proton pump inhibitor is?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so basically it's off the production of HCl, hydrochloric acid. Decreases the amount of acid in their stomach. So it's neutralizing everything in their stomach. It's making it basic instead of acidic. Now, if you're making your stomach basic instead of acidic, can you break down food effectively?
No.
So is this person getting any nutrients?
No.
How many have clients on proton pump inhibitors? You ever asked that question?
No.
Some clients have been on it for decades. Decades. So you question, how much food has this person been digesting? And when you ask these questions, paired up with when they started taking this medication, generally that's the beginning of their health decline.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So usually in their 30s or 40s, they get put on one medication.
What about people who have like medication for thyroid?
Yeah. Well, the question is, what's going on with their thyroid?
Yeah, of course. Like, let's say hypothyroidism.
Okay.
Because we're talking about weight loss.
Yeah.
So like, if they've been on medication for a while, would it affect their health the same way that we're talking about now?
For sure. Does medication do damage to your gut lining?
Yeah.
Right? All pharmaceutical medication does. Right? And so taking any med can actually do damage to you. But the big question, the bigger question, whenever you're dealing with thyroid, is why is that person's thyroid acting up? Right? Or why is it slow? Right? Does anyone know what the thyroid does for the human body? What its main job is?
Hormones.
Right? It kind of runs the hormones for your body. Works on your body's metabolism. Does your body speed up? Does it slow down? Right? We talk about fat loss. So your body's moving too slow.
Yeah.
Slow thyroid. That's why they're not losing weight. Right? So they give them this piece of this medication, their auxin or cytomel or whatever it is, based on their paneling, which OHIP doesn't really get a clear picture on anyways because they don't test enough things. And they don't ask any questions. Right? So if your thyroid focuses on your body's metabolism and your body's trying to slow you down, obviously, especially if someone had an okay like thyroid, the question is why? Right? What's their lifestyle like? Okay, so you guys want to run, right? And I got a band on you. I'm the thyroid. I'm slowing you guys down. Right? Why? What are some reasons they could be trying to slow you down? Lifestyle wise. They don't get enough sleep, so they're not recovering.
Yeah.
Okay, what else?
Stress.
Stress, right? Cortisol management. Right? The body's in what? Fight or flight versus
rest and digest.
Rest and digest. Right? What else?
Not absorbing nutrients.
Therefore they're not absorbing nutrients.
Cool.
Right? And so why are they putting on the weight now?
Okay. Issues
they have. Well, the body's not absorbing nutrients, it's in fight or flight, it starts to put on weight. Right? And then that's like, oh, I'm not losing weight because of my thyroid. No. The thyroid's trying to save your life. Right? And so what do? Oh, kick it in the ass, give it some medication, be like, okay, go harder. Right? How's that for your health long term? It's not. toxins also really affect the thyroid as well. Mm-hmm. And a lot of us are growing up in a city, toxin-filled environment, right? And once toxins get in the body, where do they go? Where are they stored?
Liver?
Well, your liver filters them if they're in their blood. Mm-hmm. Right? But a lot of toxins get stored in your fat. Okay, it's how your body protects you. Does anyone know where especially xenoestrogens or toxins go on your body?
Belly
is cortisol.
Cortisol?
Yeah, so right here is cortisol, okay? If you have a lot of xenoestrogens in you, toxins, it's kind of hamstring butt area. Right, so generally people who have more fat on their hamstrings and buttocks area are more prone, they just have more toxins, xenoestrogens in their body, and you want to figure out why. Okay, and that's usually lifestyle related, completely. Okay, people aren't born toxic. Unfortunately, people are brought up in environments where they don't know any better. Right? Okay, good question. Back to that. Sorry. So we talked about symptoms: bloating, gassiness, brain fog, indigestion. Pepto-Bismol is not the right thing to take. Right? Antacids are not the right thing to take. So, what are some things that we can do to help our digestion? Directly related to digestion.
Eat the proper foods.
Yeah, so avoiding food intolerances. Okay. What else?
Sleep.
How does sleep help digestion? What's recovering during your sleep? Why do we go to sleep? So our body can recover, right? Mm-hmm. What is recovering while we sleep? What doesn't function in the morning if you don't sleep?
Brain.
Your brain, right? What system is your brain part?
Nervous system.
Your nervous system. So when you're sleeping, your nervous system is recovering. Okay, so if you don't get a good night's sleep and then you wake up and you gotta go to work the next day, mm-hmm. right? And you're like, oh, I'm hungry and I need to eat. Fuck me. So what state is your body in? Fight or flight or rest and digest?
Fight
or flight. So is it doing a good job at digesting your food at that point in time? No. And if it's chronic, you're chronically not sleeping, are you digesting a lot of your food? Right? Or your body's just storing it all as fat because you're in that stressed out state. Right? Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
What else? These are like general topics. What can we take specifically for digestion?
Digestive
enzymes, for sure. Digestive enzymes. Those are always a good step to make sure people are digesting their food.
Probiotics.
What are probiotics do? Yes, it's your microbiome. Do you know?
Not really.
Okay, you read about it?
Yeah.
Heard about it? Anyone else? No? Okay, so your microbiome is your gut bacteria, the culture of your gut. Okay? Microbiome is affected by probiotics, right? You have good and bad bacteria in your gut. When you eat poor food, make poor food choices, have medication, drink pops and stuff like that, lots of coffee, we affect our microbiome. And that's how we can get good bacteria, more bad bacteria than good bacteria, which leads to gut problems. And so they take probiotics, right? Probiotics help you digest food when you have gut issues. Some people get better bowel movements, okay? Again, probiotics is part of the puzzle. It's not the end all, be all, okay? Your microbiome is this new field of research about how your gut flora affects your mood. Has anyone heard about that before?
Mm-hmm.
Right. If you eat poor food or have a night of drinking, how do you feel the next day? Shitty. Right? You don't feel very good at all. Right? just do your microbiome?
Mm-hmm.
So think about microbiome as this flower bed, right? It's this flower bed, nice and pretty. It's all healthy and happy. And then you go have alcohol and crappy food, mm-hmm. right? You're basically thrashing through your stamping all over your flowers, right? And you don't feel very good the next day, okay? But believe it or not, next time you do this, if you do this, take some probiotics the next day and watch how your mood changes. Okay? So what does that tell you about everyday people? People are angry and grumpy.
Mm-hmm.
How many people do you think it's just because they have poor gut bacteria?
Mm-hmm.
Poor microbiome?
Mm-hmm.
Right? We look at how a lot of people eat and treat themselves. Of course, well, how are they going to feel that way?
Mm-hmm.
Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
So this person in front of you really isn't this person, because they're being affected by their gut. Does that make sense? Okay, so probiotics, big part of it. What else is a part of it? What else can you take to help with digestion? You told me earlier today.
Fiber
helps. We want fiber helps kind of move things through your system. Right? I'm talking about like things breaking down in your body's ability to absorb it. Right? Conscious eating. Right? Just mindful eating. How many people are looking at their phone, driving and eating, doing multiple things while eating their food? So what are they not focusing on? Eating. You're not focusing on what's in front of them. Okay, so there's a saying, drink your food and chew your liquids. Okay, chew your food until it's literally liquid in your mouth. Watch how long it takes. Watch how much less you eat. Right? Your intention is focused now on eating the food in front of you. Does that make sense? Okay. How many people do you think will lose weight just by doing that? Right? People will actually digest food by chewing. If you have poor stomach acid because you're on medication and you just wolf your food down, is your body really breaking down anything? No. Right? What else? It's like two more things. Okay, so we talked about stomach acid. Right?
What about having things that are more alkaline?
In what sense?
Like lemon water or
yeah.
Keeping your body in.
Not basic state, but you want it to be kind of in the middle. Yeah, so kind of like acidic properties, right? So we talk about lemon, apple cider vinegar, right? Lemon and water, apple cider vinegar, right? Acidic properties you have in the morning, right? Around your food to help you digest food. Okay, so right, we talked about people trying to avoid things by taking in antacids, so removing acidity,
mm-hmm.
right? And now what are you doing? You're putting in acid. So what does that help do? It helps break down the food because you don't have enough. Okay. Another thing that I like to use personally, because I find it works well, is something called HCL. Okay. ATP has a great product called Enzymatic Control that actually has digestive enzymes and HCL in it together. HCL is one of three acids in your stomach that actually depletes, so it goes down when cortisol goes up. Okay? Cortisol is what hormone?
Stress.
Stress hormone. Are people stressed?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. What stresses people? And literally everything, right? The lights in this room, the technology outside, the electrical wires, those are all stressors on our body. Okay? We're meant to be out in the woods with no stress, right? So we feel so much better. So we have all these things that are stressing us out, and we deplete vitamins like magnesium and zinc. Okay? Zinc is a building block of hydrochloric acid. So if you don't have a building block, can you have enough hydrochloric acid in your stomach? No. If you don't have enough hydrochloric acid in your stomach, can you effectively digest your food?
No.
So then what do you get? Indigestion, food repeating on itself, food not breaking down properly, and gas building up and pushing back up on you, right? When I was super stressed out, I would get acid reflux. And what did I do? take hydrochloric acid pills, took a gram with my meals, and I wouldn't get acid reflux anymore. Okay, so I took more acid. Right, you always want to confer with doctors in terms of training. Like, don't start recommending things. Make sure they talk to their doctor about it, or set them up with a nutritionist.
Naturopath,
you know, RHN, registered dietitian, right? We were talking about building networks, right?
Yes.
So you want to build your network with people who that's their domain,
yes.
Right? You get the meal plan from them,
and then
from there you're the coach.
Yeah.
You work with them, right? Make sure they're doing what they're supposed to be doing, hold them accountable in whatever way that they need. Okay. Does that make sense for everyone? Okay. We'll take a 5 minute break. 2:06. If anyone need to pee, there's a washroom at the end of the hall. Okay. Anyone have any questions about what we've done so far?
I was going to ask for the digestion, like what do you think about like kimchi, kombucha, stuff like that? Like adding those to
that. That's like probiotics, right?
It's probiotics. Okay, yeah. I was going to say the same thing.
Yeah, it's
probiotics. I went out for a meal last night, and I was grumpy this morning, and then I went home drank kombucha, and I actually feel like just completely better now.
Probiotics, right?
Exactly.
So
that's what
probiotics.
You were saying.
Want to be careful with some like really sick people, people who have things like candida or you know, yeast, fungal overgrowth. All that stuff grows with fermentation, right? So there's a lot of people having mooch right now. Not everyone's going to feel better drinking kombucha or kimchi or those fermented foods, right? So just be, again, you want to be careful who you're recommending things to because you don't know all the details, right? But generally, yeah, for sure, definitely good for you. Any other questions? No? Okay. So I will be sending everything to you guys that we went over today, like kind of like summed up. I didn't quite know where things were gonna go, so you'll get to that today as a takeaway. Send it to you after. I want to talk about leaky gut. Has anyone heard of leaky gut? Yeah. Okay. What is it? What do we know about leaky gut? No idea.
I know that it causes a bunch of different symptoms.
Yeah. Okay. What can it cause?
I know we talked about this for like acne and things like that, a lot of skin problems.
Yeah, yeah.
I've heard
he's
used IBS Crohn's.
Okay, what else?
Like most of the symptoms we talked earlier, like fogginess.
Yeah. Does anyone know how leaky gut's caused?
The holes in your intestine, it leaks through your intestines.
Yeah, right? So, leaky gut is. That word again. Inflammation. Right? It's inflammation of the gut lining. And what did we say can cause that? Medication. Yeah, what else? Food allergies. Good, right? We're grouping it together now, guys. We're trying to put it all together. Okay, so you got medication. We got food intolerances. What else?
Stress.
Cortisol, right? Cortisol breaks down the gut lining. Okay, so whatever capacity stress is, whether it is food, right? Food intolerances, could be sleep, lack of sleep. Okay, or it could be too much exercise. Okay, right? It's a cortisol response overall. Right, we have this cortisol bucket. Right, exercise goes in here, sleep goes in here, water goes in here, relationships, money, psyche, right, outlook, where you are, how you look at things, right, the stories you tell yourself, because you can stress yourself out. Does that make sense? Right. So, we have inflammation of the gut lining. What happens next? What does that cause? What is the result of this inflammation? Malabsorption. Okay. So now, your body's not digesting nutrients like B12, magnesium, and zinc. Right? You're not getting any nutrients out of your food anymore. Right? So what happens to your health at that point in time?
Deteriorates.
What do you feel first? What do you think people feel first when
Tired.
sluggish, right? You have no energy, right? So what do?
Drink more coffee.
Drink more coffee. Yeah. What happens shortly after that?
You crash.
Pounds start to pack on, right? They feel more shitty. They want to feel good, so they want to feel good when they eat.
Comfort food.
Comfort food. Is comfort food good for you or your physique? Okay. So, we have inflammation of the gut lining, we have malabsorption. Next, we have an immune response. Right. Because of what's going on here, right, there's inflammation, the gut's on fire, malabsorption, now we're not digesting nutrients. Right, we've got this breakdown of the gut lining, we've got holes in our gut lining, and these food particles are getting into our bloodstream. They're not supposed to be there. Right? They're not broken down. Our immune system starts to attack it because they think it's bad because our stress is here, right? So now we have an immune response, which we said was an IgG response, right? What's next? We have this immune response. Okay.
Chronic.
Yeah, so now it gets chronic, right? We get multiple food intolerances, going to be FI. Right, we get multiple food intolerances, and we start to get a chronic immune response. Right, we start to get this chronic immune response. Okay, so what's the health status of this person at this point in time? What do we think? How far into this immune response? So how many years do you think that this process takes? Multiple years, right? Let's give me some numbers here. What do you think?
5 to 7 years.
5 to 7 years, okay. What else? Any other thoughts?
Okay.
For me, it happened in probably 2.
Oh, wow.
Right? Probably 2. Maybe 1.5. Okay? I was doing too much. I was doing too many things. Right? I was prepping for a show. I had a gym in Ottawa. I had too many things going on. Dog, too many things. Okay. I was studying on the side, right? Superman, doing it all. Okay, cortisol was here. I love what I'm doing, right? So here's the difference. I love what I'm doing. I'm passionate about it, and so I have energy, and I'm not like depressed all day. That doesn't mean that this like avatar, this human body here, can keep up. Okay, right? I gotta listen to what it's telling me. So yeah, I don't feel stressed because I love what I'm doing. Right? People don't annoy me. Well, they do, but right? But my body couldn't keep up. And so I started to develop these food intolerances. I got, you know, heartburn, acid reflux. That is not a healthy state. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
And spinach, oatmeal, all the lettuce, avocado, bell peppers, sweet potatoes, butter, all food dyes. I stopped all supplementation in terms of like protein shakes, BCAAs, sucralose, all the different food dyes. Bananas, oranges, kiwi, cherries, you name it. Like, all these things I couldn't have, right? Which tells me I'm here, right? I'm at this phase. But a year and a half prior, I was fine and not having diarrhea all the time, okay? And then, as we said, the next step. Does anyone know anyone with autoimmunity or autoimmune issues? Yeah. Right? So that's where we're looking, you know, 5, 7 years, 10 years, right? The rate at which this body is degraded.
Would that be like hyperthyroidism too? That kind of is an autoimmunity?
Does it? Is it in
can be.
It can be, for sure. If your body's attacking your thyroid, yeah, for sure. Some people have that. Yeah, just depends. Right? But many people, what do we see now? Crohn's, ulcerative colitis, right? All sorts of IBS. Right? What happens, right? You go to the hospital, you're bloating, you're gassy, you got indigestion, you go to the doctor, who do they refer you to?
Specialist,
right? What type of specialist?
Gastroenterologist.
What do they want to do?
Give me a medication.
You want to give me an endoscope. You want to look at your butt.
Yeah.
You want to see what's going on. That's cool. Right? They're going to look at your butt and they're going to see something like IBS or Crohn's or ulcerative colitis or whatever it is. And what do they tell you?
Take this.
No, they tell you what you have. Here's medication. See you never. Don't eat this. Is that a way to live? No. So what did they do? What did they address? They told you what you got based on your symptoms and this test result. Take this medication. Okay, I'm not against medication as a time and place, but people don't ask enough questions. Okay?
Sure.
Right? People don't ask, doctors don't ask questions. They say, here, this is what you got, take this med. Right? There's tons of reasons why these things are happening, right? So medication, go home. So now this person has no follow-up, no coaching, no idea what's going on. Okay? Now, if you identify what's irritating someone's bowel. So let's say they do an endoscope and you find IBS, okay, or the doctor finds symptoms or evidence of IBS. What's going on? Why does this person have IBS?
Could be one of the issues we talked about. Right?
One of the issues we talked about. What is it like? Just think about what could it be?
Stress.
I just gave you a bunch of food intolerances. Mm-hmm. If I continue to eat these things, if you know they give me diarrhea, mm-hmm. what is it doing to my bowels? It's inflaming them. It's causing this irritation that's making me go to the bathroom. Now, if I do this for long enough, will that cause IBS?
Yes.
Will I have symptomology? If I scratch my skin, will I have a rash? Because I'm scratching my skin. Right? If you remove the food intolerance that's irritating the bowel and they do another endoscope, do you think that they'll still have IBS? Probably not. Right? If I start scratching myself, my rash will go away. Right? I had a client in Ottawa. She's complaining about diarrhea every day, so she's not digesting her food, so she's feeling pretty ill, right? I'm like, you gotta get you digesting food, let's increase your fiber. She increased her fiber, it got worse. I was like, what did you increase? Kale. Kale is your favorite vegetable. What did I do? I was like, you need to get some food intolerance testing that. We figured out kale, super intolerant to it. Within probably a week to a week and a half of removing kale, she went from having diarrhea for 6 to 8 months to not having it at all.
Jeez.
Just off of kale, among a few other food. But that's the power of food that it has in your body. Okay? So what did we have to do? We had to ask questions and identify. Right? And if you don't do an IgG test or a food intolerance test, that's okay. You can do a food rotation diet where you're having some of the same food groups.
Mm-hmm.
Right? The issue I have with that is you can be intolerant to chicken and eggs and not beef or turkey.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? You know, how did I figure out that I'm intolerant to lettuce and spinach but not... Right? There's a lot of trial and error when you go that way.
Mm-hmm.
So it's much quicker to get a test done. Okay? Does that make sense for leaky gut?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Something I want to talk about, something I want to talk about right now would be what we can do. So it doesn't matter where they are, it just takes longer,
mm-hmm.
right? And the longer people are in that state, it usually gets more and more complicated.
Mm-hmm.
When I work with fibro clients, right, is anyone know what fibromyalgia is?
Yeah.
Okay, fibromyalgia is the set of symptomology, right, that they classify as fibro, okay? And that usually involves, you know, nerve pain all over the place, chronic fatigue that they can't get out of bed, you know, doing basic tasks. Really difficult for them, and they have so many things going on paper that you don't even know where to start.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, but where do you think it starts?
In the gut,
and it's usually decades before they get there. Right, people with fibromyalgia also find a lot of drugs. Drugs, I mean toxins, chemicals. They work at hair salons. They've done a lot of drugs in their past. A lot of micronutrition deficiencies. And then their microbiome is in such a weak state, you start to see things like yeast infections, candida, possible parasites. That's usually what I see. Okay, I work with a lot of post-show clients. Okay, Okay, so people who compete, what state is their body in?
Fight
or flight. So that means cortisol is high. Are they sleeping? No, they're on tons of supplements, right? Energetically, are they in a good place? Not all the time, right? Not everyone competes for the right reason, right? It creates this host environment for these things to come live and break you down, right? How many people post show they can't eat this, they can't eat that, they can't recover, right? They can't sleep. They can't lose the weight. Cardio and dropping food doesn't count anymore, doesn't work anymore, right? Okay, so we want to prevent it slash reverse it. What do we need to do?
Determine what's
effective. Okay, so let's do this. So what? So we talked about the things that cause leaky gut, right? And remember those? Okay, so now we want to reverse it. So if cortisol, in effect, causes leaky gut, what do we need to manage?
Stress.
Okay. Manage stress. Right? This is how simple it is, right? So we got to manage stress. We got to identify where the stress is coming from. Okay, so when I work with a contest prep client, and you know, their post-show, all these foods are giving them issues, they can't sleep, they're doing all this cardio, they're dieting, and they can't lose weight. What's the first thing you think I do in their life? In terms of their exercise?
Tell them to slow down?
Yeah.
What do I do to their cardio?
Cut it out,
remove it. Because what is cardio?
Stress.
So remove that, done. So the body has just got a whole bunch of extra physical energy to recoup. If they're not doing cardio, what are they probably doing? Sleeping, right? That's what people are getting up for cardio. Okay, what else in terms of their exercise? What am I doing to their weight training program?
Deloading,
right? It's not nervous system work. It's not endurance work. Very simple, you know, 8 to 10 to 12, get in the gym 3 to 4 times a week. Very simple movements, nothing difficult, right? Walking. Right, getting them to ground themselves, yoga, right? You have to identify where the stress is coming from, okay? Those are the easy things. And then food, exercise and food are the easy things. Once you get into people's financials and mental state, that gets a lot more complicated. Mm-hmm. But those are things that you have to address as well, okay? Manage stress. What else?
Identify food intolerances.
Food intolerances. So I'm going to write decrease inflammation, okay? Because a lot of inflammation is going to come from your food choices, right? That's the biggest thing that you can control. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
What else?
Sleep
routine. Yeah, sleep. Sleep's going to help manage stress. What else can we keep an eye on? What's aspirin?
Pardon me?
What's aspirin?
What's
a
opener?
Well, aspirin is a medication which is a toxin,
mm-hmm.
Right? Okay. Is alcohol toxic to our bodies?
Yes.
Yes. Right? Toxins. How much toxins are you putting into your body? Okay. I once heard that alcohol makes your stomach bleed. I don't know if that's true. I've heard that once. Toxins. Okay, could be medication, could be alcohol, right? If you're eating McDonald's burgers,
mm-hmm.
Right, who knows what those are? Okay, these are things you're putting into your stomach.
Mm-hmm.
McDonald's burger can sit for a few years and look the same, and it doesn't burn when you put a blowtorch to it, right? But we eat it, okay? And then our bodies do what? Spit it right out. Right, so did we eat anything?
Mm-hmm.
No, we just wasted $20 at McDonald's. We gave someone else money. Okay. Pathogens. Where's your immune system? Where's most of your immune system? Your skin. No, not your skin. Skin is a detox organ. And it for sure helps against pathogens, right? Because it's this airtight thing all around us, right? But where's the majority of our immune system? In our gut, right? Your 75% of your gut is your immune system, mm-hmm. right? So if you have poor gut health, your immune system is going to be poor, therefore you're going to get sick all the time, mm-hmm. right? If you ever ask anyone who like has that cold that's like chronically there, right? If you look at somebody, say, you know, we got three or four people up here at the front, and if you look at them, one looks like they don't sleep. The other one, their skin may look bad, so they're kind of acne or breakouts. The other person just looks drained, right? Kind of like zombie-like, kind of pale skin. And then the other person, say, has eczema, right? How many of those people do you think have gut issues?
All of them.
All of them, right? Because all these things all start from the gut, right? Could be they're not digesting food, right? You look at the eczema, could be some sort of pathogen or microbiome issue. Right? Are they not absorbing nutrients and that's why they look like a zombie? Right? Are they not sleeping and recovering? Are they getting nutrients? Right? These are all the questions you start to ask people before you even, what's my meal plan and training program? I want to lose 10 pounds and feel better. Right? Like, what does that mean? You have no idea what you're talking about. You know? Just because I give you these two pieces of paper doesn't mean you're going to lose weight or feel better. Right? Like, for me, there's no such thing as, like, okay, here's a training program, nutrition plan, bye. Like, that's cool, I can give you this, and it may not be right for you at all because of how you feel after you started. Right? I can't make a meal plan for you if I don't know your food intolerances. Because that's just irresponsible of me. Right? So when you figure out and you learn more and you learn these things, people just, they don't know what they don't know, right? And so you have to help educate them to understand these are the factors you want to look at and include before you even decide what you should be eating. And that's, and is this macros? Am I talking macros?
No,
this is micronutrition, right? We're talking about what our body needs to feel better. What are macros? What are their influence on our body?
Macros?
Yeah. Where we get energy from. So we're dictating, you know, how much energy comes from protein, fat, and carb, mm-hmm. right? Now, what does that affect mainly on our body? These macros. Body composition, right? Is that the main responsibility of macros? Right? We want to know how much we're eating, okay? So that's BMR. We want to make sure we're eating enough food based on how much we burn on a daily basis. But after that, macros is simply based on fat, right? Body composition. Do I have enough muscle? Do I have, or am I trying to lose fat, right? Well, those are the two goals, right? Does that make sense? Okay. Does that have anything to do with health? Afterwards. That's more food choices,
yeah.
right? The issue here in North America that I find anyways is that our soil isn't nutritious. There's nothing in the soil. Our soil is very over-farmed. So the quality of food here in North America is very different than you find in Europe, mm-hmm. as Roland has experienced. Okay, you can attest to that, the food's better over there?
Yeah, it's way better.
I've never been to Europe, so I don't know how the food tastes, but I heard it's a lot better.
I've
had clients that go to Europe and they lose weight on vacation and come back here and they gain weight. And why is that? If your food has more like nutrients in the food and your body's getting those nutrients, does it need to hold on to fat? No, it starts to let go of it. Right? Also, they're probably walking and doing a lot more things over there as well. The temperature is a little different. Right? But there's stress-free, right? There's a bunch of factors that play into that. A lot of that's water as well, right? So there's a lot of things. But macros, I think that people only focus on for the physique comp and not on organ health, which is a big issue that I find in terms of our coaches that we have on the market today and people helping people lose weight, mm-hmm. right? Because it's all superficial and these people are not getting any better,
mm-hmm.
right? Okay. I want to talk about terms of pathogens. Once you get to that autoimmunity state, right, that last state of breaking down your gut, and you get, people start to get really sick and you start to see the spin-off of it happening to other organs. Pathogens are really common. So those are things like, you know, yeast infections that are systemic. So just because, you know, you have a yeast infection that comes and goes, just because it goes away, doesn't mean you got rid of what caused it, right? If you have, if someone has athlete's foot, right, they have some sort of like fungal infection systemically, and not to the point that it's causing major health concerns, but if it comes and goes, right? So if this person then, you know, doesn't get a lot of sleep, start to run down their immune system, that infection will spark back up.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so it's not actually out of your system. It's just not bad enough that it's prevalent, right? Girls go on antibiotics, what do they get? Yeast infections. Because antibiotics wipe out your whole immune system and your gut culture.
Mm-hmm.
So that means it's systemic, it means it's there. Right? Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay, so see, these are some of the deeper concepts that people struggle with, because their health can never get to 100% at that point. It kind of hovers here. They feel good, right? They got energy, but they hit a ceiling that they don't know about, because these things are chronic. How it comes about, how you can affect it, how you can prevent it. Okay. So, prevention, manage stress, decrease inflammation, toxins, identify pathogens. Right. Look at some of the other symptomology. Now I want to talk about. Okay, so let's say you got leaky gut. What do you do then? Who's got an idea? How many of us sort of think you have leaky gut to some degree? Yeah, okay. Alright, so you guys, this is for you guys, right? So we want to heal. So we want to heal leaky gut. Okay, what are you gonna do?
Decrease inflammation in the gut lining.
First step, we talked about food tolerances. Okay, we want to remove the thing breaking down our gut lining. Okay, we want to focus on sleep, water, all that mumbo jumbo. What supplements? Okay, we talked about some lifestyle stuff. What are some major subs that we can use to help rebuild our gut here, right? Some of you in this room have it, right? These are things that we can be doing right after this.
Fish oil.
Fish oil, that helps with it. That helps with inflammation, for sure. So that can help with overall gut health. Right. We want to talk about specifically healing that gut lining.
Which is enzymes.
Yeah, enzymes take the load off the body. Okay, so I'm going to go HCL. What's enzymes? Oops. What else?
Probiotics.
Probiotics. Then what are you going to say?
Glutamine.
Yeah, glutamine. Tell me about glutamine, Meg.
I don't know. You put it in my shake every morning.
Does anyone know what glutamine does for the body?
Does it help heal the body?
Yeah. Glutamine helps with cell permeability. Okay, so it helps your body actually pull things into the cell. When you're super low carb, glutamine actually acts kind of like a carb, like an energy source for you, right? And glutamine helps rebuild your gut lining. Okay, but in order to do that, your body needs enough EEAs for that to happen. So if someone has leaky gut and they're not consuming adequate protein sources, can they have issues rebuilding their gut lining? Yes, I see this in vegans and vegetarians a lot. Okay, vegans, vegetarians. Okay, so I want to touch on that really quickly,
yeah.
Just because that's what you're here for.
Well, I'm not here for that.
Okay. Are you a vegan yourself?
I'm getting into it.
Okay, sweet. So for me, I'm not against any diet. Right? You want to be vegan, you want to be vegetarian. Do what you gotta do, that's cool. We all have our reasons for it. I'm about listening to what your body has to tell you, right? So if your body is telling you that it doesn't like meat right now, you should remove meat and like decrease inflammation, for sure, right? I'm of the advocate that your body needs animal, right? It needs protein. It needs animal sources of protein, okay? When I do food intolerance testing on vegans, vegetarians, they're often intolerant to many vegetables and many of those plant-based protein sources. So they're actually not helping themselves, they're hurting themselves. Does that make sense? Okay. So I'm just going off of what the results tell me of the food intolerance test. So I use the example, I had a client who's a vegan, and she was pretty sick, right? Really low energy, lots of bloating, everything. She always ate the same thing, it was always bothering her. So we did a food intolerance test, and more or less all the foods that she was eating we're stressing her out. Okay, so what are the first thing we did? We had to remove those things. But being a vegan, you're very limited, right? So now you're going from a limited food list to an even more limited food list. So So in terms of micronutrients, right, you just went from the vast earth and what we can get to like this, right? So how do you think that's going to go long term for your body? Not well, right? Especially if you're an advocate of not using supplements, because vegans and vegetarians are like that, whole food, right? So it's nothing against you, it's nothing against these individuals, but as a group, that's how they tend to operate, right? And that can lead to a lot of health issues for a lot of people. Right, I've had cases where, you know, you have vegan parents putting veganism on a child. The child needs animal protein.
But why? Why do you need animal protein?
Everyone's body's different. What if someone can't digest plant proteins very well?
Well, then, yeah, that's when you deal with that stressor, right? That
but they don't, but how does it people know this? People
they
don't always,
they
but many people don't even know about food intolerance testing. Right, so
they
that's the thing. It's the uneducation. There's nothing wrong with being a vegan.
Yeah.
There's nothing wrong with it. It's the uneducation part, right? What the health comes out with an article saying eggs are like cigarettes, like sorry, a free range egg, like from if I got it from a farm out in the East End, probably not the quality of a cigarette, right?
Yeah.
For sure, food choices. If you're getting commercially raised food, yeah, the energetics of that meat is really low. And it's not the best for your health. But if I had a commercially grown chicken versus a organic or free-range chicken, I can taste the difference, right? I went down to Texas and I bought eggs at a grocery store and then free-range organic ones, and the yolk wasn't yellow, it was orange. It was so good, the best egg I've ever had in my life.
It's like that in Europe too, right? Like
yeah, right? Again, it's the food quality here in North America, and people don't know. And they're like, oh, I'm just going to the grocery store and getting this, right? Costco made that big change to put organic food in there now, right? Whether it's all money or not, who knows? But I go based on the taste of my food, and the food that's organic or free-range tastes way better, right? And that's why you can never find it at Costco. It's always gone now, right? Again, it's listening to your body, listening to food, listening to how your body reacts to what you're eating, okay? And if you feel a certain way, and your lifestyle is a certain way, and you don't want to feel this way, then what should you change? Something you're doing, right? If you're a vegan, a vegetarian, or a meat eater, or whatever, and you don't feel good, you got to change something, right? There's a lot of meat eaters and you know meat and potatoes type of people that have so many health concerns because they don't eat enough greens, right? It's vice versa, right? For me, it's here's the person, what's good for them, what does their body need, right? Like. That one girl I was thinking of, but I'm thinking about as a vegan, she wants to put on muscle mass, but she's not eating enough protein to support her goals, and she's intolerant to plant-based sources. So right now, it's just not the best option for her body, right?
Based on her goals, yeah.
Based on her goals, right? It always goes back to your goals.
Yeah.
If you tell me this is what you want,
yeah.
I'm gonna try to get you there. Right, unfortunately, but if you don't want to do it because X, Y, and Z, then it's your choice. Right, I can't force anyone to do that. Okay, so we have food intolerances, HL enzymes, probiotics, EAAs. What is the biggest thing we need to do? Where did I say destroys your gut lining? Yes. What do you do to yourself that destroys your gut lining?
Stress.
Rolling was telling me this morning not to stress out. Right, so I'm destroying my gut this morning. Yeah, right? We do this to ourselves, right? I was like, oh, you should be so excited about this. Nah, I was a bit nervous and scared, so my cortisol is going up. Right? We do that to ourselves. I did it to the event today, but people do this every day with life, right? So in essence, they're putting themselves into the fight or flight state versus a rest and digest state. Now, does that have anything to do with supplements? No? Does it have anything to do with their lifestyle?
Yeah.
Yeah, lifestyle plays into it, but a lot of it, right? You can put two different people into the same lifestyle and have two results.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah.
Right? So it's less lifestyle, it's less supplements, it's more mental space, okay? There are ideas around like self-love, energetics, right? I work with people in pain and work on some energetics or mindfulness or like thought process, and that alone has a result with people with their pain and without me touching them. Okay, right? So that's an important aspect as well. That's what we talked about, journaling, meditation, right? Working through the subconscious brain. It's just as important as supplements, right? We look at what's happening. You know, there's now MRI studies to show that meditation is great. It shows our brain activity come down. But it took an MRI machine for Western medicine to accept that's sitting there and like saying, oh, meditating is good for you. Right? And that society, that's the society we live in. That's the culture we live in. Everything has to be proven. Okay? You don't always need proof. Sometimes you just got to feel what works for you. Okay?
Good. Any questions
on that?
Am I losing everyone? Okay, let's take a 5-minute break. And then we're going to go over.
Send you an X with you guys. Wrap it on up. Okay. Questions?
No. We're okay. We just went over the questions. You have any questions, Mom?
No.
That all makes sense. Okay. Syndrome X. So, we talk about food intolerances and how they destroy your gut lining. And we talked about leaky gut. Okay, leaky gut seems to be this big idea of our gut lining simply not working, right? This concept of our gastrointestinal system not doing its job. Maybe we can all establish that. That's what it is, right? Now, if we have leaky gut, our gut is to do what? Break down food, assimilate nutrients. If it's not doing that, what else is affected in the body? Everything. Does that make sense? Obviously we get food sensitivities if our gut isn't functioning. We get joint issues. We get adrenal issues. We get skin issues. Thyroid issues. See how leaky gut can play out into different organs. Okay. What do you have a lot of?
Sinus
issues.
Big time.
Okay. When does it start for you? Mucus in your throat. Okay. So when I have ice cream, I get mucus buildup.
Yeah.
And I snore. Okay? Because so, I know that's ice cream. It shouldn't happen. Right? So I figured out what causes it for me. And you have it all the time. Right?
Yeah, but since I did my food testing, and if I keep away from dairy, I don't have it. Like, my nostrils is a lot clearer.
Good. Right? But we think about people. So before you did your food intolerance, what would you do? Or people
reacting.
Yeah, or anti-congestion medication, whatever that is. Right.
Okay. I went to the doctor to give me medication.
Yeah.
I don't like medication.
Right. So people may think they have an allergy to something, but it's just what they're eating. Okay. Here's your sinus and mouth issues. Right? These people not breathing. Okay. How hard is it? How many people know how to breathe properly? Okay, you guys laugh. How many people know how to breathe properly? Silence. Not a lot. Okay, how do you take a proper breath?
Does it come from your stomach or like from the
Okay, which one do you think is a proper breath? Breathing from here?
No.
Or here? Second one. Okay, why the second one? What's happening to your diaphragm? Yeah, so if you take a chest breath, right? I'm going up like this. I'm using my neck, okay? My scalenes, right? My intercostal muscles. I'm using all these secondary breathing muscles to breathe, okay? If you're working out, are you breathing up here or are you breathing down here? If you're
you're working out, which one are you breathing? So what is your body doing? Diaphragmatic, right? Right? People are usually in a chest breathing state. They're usually all up here stuck in their neck. Okay, not enough people know how to belly breathe. If you do some belly breathing yoga class, what do you feel? A sense of calm. Relax. Okay. If you're trying to sleep and you're like, because your mind's running like a million miles an hour, are you going to sleep? No. No, I got people on my massage table. And I'm not even like going very hard, and they're all just like stuff like this. I'm like, ah, breathe, hands on your belly, like, relax. You know? Because you're like amping yourself up too. Right? It starts with breathing. Okay? Does anyone know what a normal breath is supposed to be in and out? Paul Check says it's 10 seconds. 10 seconds in, 10 seconds out. You should be able to get to that kind of capacity. But what do we do? Quick in and out, right? We don't even know how to slow our body down to breathe in for 10 seconds and then out for 10 seconds. Mm-hmm. Okay. That makes sense. Okay, we're talking about sign of smell. Brain, what's going on with the brain? How can leaky gut or some things we're talking about today affect your brain? What can we see? What diseases or symptomology can we see in the brain?
Memory.
Okay, memory loss. What else? Okay, think about, so let's take less about symptomology and like things you see in friends you have, family members you have. What brain conditions? Depression. Good, what else?
Anxiety.
What else?
Is insomnia?
Sure, could be. You gotta look at the reasoning. Parasites can cause you to stay awake too. Right, they're on opposite REM cycles. That's how I figure out a lot of my parasite cases actually, based on their sleep patterns. Right, what else? Depression, anxiety, ADHD, ADD. Okay. I mean, there's a lot of studies that show that's a deficiency in fish oil, right? Specifically DHA. Right? Depression. Okay. What else can affect depression? Does anyone have ideas of what depression is? Okay. What is that? Where's serotonin made? Gut.
Is it?
Yeah. Majority of serotonin is made in your gut. Okay, so you don't dig into your belly, you're going to be happy? No. Right? Talk about probiotics as well. Okay. Depression. It's interesting. Okay. It's twofold. For sure, food can cause depression issues. Right? If you're not doing what you love, your passion, okay, if you're not doing what fires up your soul, are you going to be happy? No. Will you feel depressed?
Yeah.
Have a rain cloud over you every day. Right? They say depression is deep rest. It means your soul needs deep rest. People who are depressed are always what? Tired. Right? Because they're just dragging through life doing things that they don't want to do. And all they do is sleep to pass the time. Yeah, I've gone through my moments. Literally like sleep away days. Not leave my condo, right? Doing things that I didn't want to do. Okay. And I know it seems like I'm like, I've always been in the industry doing what I want to do, but if you don't have the power to say no or use your voice, then you're doing things you don't want to do, which a lot of people live in, right? And so it comes to show how important the mind state, the mental state is, and making sure that you're focusing on, you know, not so much a meal plan or a workout program, and more of, are you doing what makes you happy? Right? Can you find happiness in what you do? Is it a perspective issue? We always think grass is greener on the other side, the grass is greener where you water it. Right? You can have 100 flowers and still be unhappy, you can have one flower and be the happiest person there is. Right? What joint issues are we talking about? I talked about one earlier. Okay. Arthritis. What else? Let me see, in terms of joint. Things like tendonitis, okay, fibro, supposedly a joint thing. People feel a lot of joint pain, nerve pain. Okay, rheumatoid arthritis is a big one. they say that's autoimmune. Okay? When you're born with it, it's genetic. Taking some medication for it. No. Food intolerances. Right? Have some fish oil. Drink some water. Right? If you're sick to the point that you need medication, have medication. But if you're not doing these basics, and you're just doing the medication, then what do you expect? Right? Adrenal. Okay. So adrenal, you're just ties up with adrenal fatigue. We talked about the brain. Right? If you're not feeding yourself, your nervous system, your wiring is going to be ramped up. Right? It's going to be trying to get you to keep pushing, keep going, but you don't want to. Your body doesn't want to. So this is where people with adrenal fatigue, so to speak, are usually very unhappy as well. So that's kind of the twofold aspect. Right? Thyroid, right? Hypo. Right? So this thyroid is either speeding up or slowing down, or you can have a situation where the body's actually attacking its own thyroid in terms of autoimmunity. The question though is, why is that happening? Right? So it's always just about asking enough questions. Right? Colon. Constipation, diarrhea, IBS. Skin. What else we see on the skin? What are the things we talked about with skin?
Rash, thyroid, acne.
Acne, hormonal stuff. Detox systems. Stress. Right? Does that make sense? Okay, so if someone has, let's do a little case study here. If someone comes to me, they want to lose 20 pounds. Okay, she's a woman, she's 40. She wants to lose 20 pounds. She's a CEO, high stress job, sleeps 4 to 5 hours a night. Most of her fat is here on her midsection. She's got peg legs, kind of peg legs with an apple in the midsection. She doesn't have time to work out. She sleeps, 4 to 5 hours a night, doesn't get enough sleep, eats out with clients a lot. Right, where do you think we need to start with her? What are the questions we need to ask? What are the questions? So I want to teach you guys a question. What are you asking, either yourself or people around you? Right?
What type of job do you do?
Okay, what type of job? Right? So we know she's a CEO, so it's obviously stressful, right?
Yeah.
So are we focusing on how to remove stress from her life? And then we're focusing on how to deal with stress. I would ask her to quit her job.
Yeah.
Try to make sure they get money that she's paying you as well. Right?
That's
so we don't want to remove that, but we want to figure out how can we manage her stress. Okay, so what questions are we asking them?
Or maybe even how she can manage her time.
How she can manage her time. Right? Maybe she needs an assistant and it's just too cheap. Right? Lifestyle habits, right? I was trying to do it all. I was like, I need someone else to do stuff that I don't care about. Okay, so I just say, so now I'm not thinking about it. It comes to me and done. Right? So what other questions are you asking here?
Ask her what she does for like personal time, like downtime, me time.
Yeah, what is a me time? Okay. What do you do for me time? You meditate.
What do you color?
Or you color. Hey, what do you do for me time?
I paint.
You paint. And you box.
Read books or do yoga.
Read books or yoga. Working out.
I'll be honest.
What's me time, Roland?
I don't know me time.
Okay. What's me time?
Hiking.
Okay.
Working on video games.
Watching TV.
Okay, watching
TV.
Okay. What does watching TV do for you?
Nothing.
So what are you doing by watching TV?
Starting to work out.
No. What are you doing by watching TV? Like, what are you doing for yourself? Like, you said it's me time, right?
Mm-hmm.
So what do you get out of watching TV? No, I'm asking. I know you think it's
bad.
I'm asking what you get out of it.
Rest.
Right? There's some people watch TV just to turn their brain off. Okay. And there's nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with turning your brain off. But obviously, if you can turn your brain off by meditating, you're going for a hike or reading a book is a better option than watching TV. Okay. So she's doing it for a reason. Right? She wants to turn her brain off, shut her brain off. But is it the healthiest option? No. Is there anything wrong with the fact that she's watching TV? No. It's fine. That's where she is right now. Right? If there's something else that we can work on, yeah, probably. If that's what she does for me time, am I going to take that away?
No.
makes her happy. It's her thing, right? But there's other things we can work on, right? So a lot of it is lifestyle coaching. And you don't need, you know, a nutritionist certain to do any of these things. Can all these things that we're talking about help people?
Yeah.
Yeah. Can it drastically improve their health?
Yeah.
Yeah. What else? Okay, what other questions are we asking this girl?
Is she drinking water?
Is she drinking water? Probably not. What's she probably drinking?
Coffee.
Coffee. It's even best when my guys are intolerant to coffee. Because then I get them off of caffeine. Mm-hmm. And it's a food intolerance. So immediately they're going to start to drop. What do people drop as soon as you remove inflammation? Water. So now they're going down a couple pounds. So what is that? Motivation. Mm-hmm. Right? They're happy. They're excited. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay, what else am I asking?
How frequently are you eating throughout the day?
How frequently are you eating? So what are we trying to get out of her basket?
First of all, whether she's actually eating throughout the day, making sure she has proper macro or micronutrients, and if she's going to meetings with clients, and if that's her only kind of meal for the day in between getting from point A to point B.
Yeah. Okay. So we established she's eating with her clients. So that means she's eating what? Did she make the food or did someone else make it? Someone else made it. Okay. You never know what's in the food someone else makes. Never know. Energetically, it's never good either, right? You don't know if this person is angry when they meet your food. You're taking off to that. You're going to meal made with love, right? Man, this stuff's important, okay? So she's not making her food, all right? It's probably processed to some degree, right? And using fats, preservatives, things to keep the food good because she's not making it herself, right? Another question, is she eating enough food? Okay, so if people are overweight, what do they eat these days? If they're overweight and they're trying to lose weight, let me correct that. What are they eating?
Shakes.
Low carb.
Shakes, low carb. Okay, so low carb, what are they having?
They might have they might do no carb where it's like no like grain, vegetables, or grain products.
Yeah, so what do the meals consist of?
Usually it's like
meat and like salad.
Yeah.
Of some sort. Okay. So on a caloric standpoint, how many calories are they having in a day? If they're having, you know, say some eggs in the morning and then two other meals, right, breakfast and dinner, because what people eat, of meat and vegetables.
Maybe like 1,000 calories?
1,000, right, 1,200 if not. Does anyone know the average BMR of a person? Okay, we're all different because we're all different sizes and have different energy. You know what, most people are in the range of kind of 12 to 1,500 based on, you know, your stature, how much muscle you have, your activity level, all of that. Right, but generally 12 to 1500. How many people do you think eat that much food in a day? Right? If you're eating 2,000 to 2,400 calories, which I've had some of people in this room do before, you know, you think you're eating a lot of food. Right? People think you're eating a lot of food. Are you really eating that much food though? No, you're not. Right? And if you're constantly in a caloric negative, so not eating enough food to sustain your body, when you eat food, what does your body do?
Stores
it. Right? We're talking really general concepts here, but yeah, right? The body stores it because it doesn't know when it's going to get more food. And so these people eat more and more steak and salad and work out harder and harder. And you know, there becomes a forced adaptation where the body does start to like lose weight, but it stops at something, right? And people get stuck. That's when the cardio doesn't work. Less food doesn't work. Does that make sense? Okay. So making sure she's getting enough food is important. It's a good question. How much are you eating in a day? She eats out all the time. Okay. What can we do for her to help her with that?
Understand portion sizing?
Yeah, sure. Help her understand portion sizing. What else can we do?
Pre-plan meals, basically. Before you go places.
Yeah, so what are we doing? We're going to help her find restaurants if she gets to choose or places she can go that are good for her, right? Things that support this lifestyle that she's trying to have, right? Educate her on food choices as to where she's going and what she should be choosing, okay? What other questions can we ask this woman? How's her sleep?
Yeah,
so you said she's only getting 4 or 5 hours of sleep. Okay, so first you ask her how her sleep is, right? Let's say she says her sleep is amazing. She wakes up at 4:30, ready to go. Okay, what do you say then? Yeah, I feel great. I wake up ready to go. I go to bed at midnight and wake up 4:30, ready to go. What do you do then? She wants to lose weight though. And when I say most of her weight was on her stomach. So what does that mean?
Stress.
But she sleeps great. She's not getting enough sleep. Okay? Right? Your brain, her nervous system is ramped up. It's ready to go. Right? Whatever her business plan is, she's excited. Okay, that's what's keeping her awake. Is her body getting into that rest state? Probably not.
Yeah.
Going. Exactly. Right? The amount of people I ask how you sleep, they're like, oh, good. I only get up 3 times to compete. People don't know what good is. Good is relative to you. I'm like, how do you poop? Great. I'm regular. What's regular? Once a week, once like a day, after every meal, right? Everyone is good. They're great. They don't want to talk about anything. Like, describe your poops. Well, you know, I go regular. Well, what is that? What's going regular? And then you ask the questions, you know? Is it solid? Is it 6 inches? Is it mulch? Is it diarrhea? Right? Is it a pile? You're like, oh yeah, it's like a pile. But I go like after every meal. Okay, that's not good. You know? Your body's not digesting food at that point. It's just spitting it out. Right? Okay? For those of you who don't know, a good bowel movement is 6 inches. Solid, light brown. That is what a good, healthy bowel movement is. 1 to 2 times a day. Depending on who you talk to, they'll argue that. But for me, it's like, if you're 1 to 2 times a day, pretty good. Okay? The biggest thing is a solid stool. What else do we have to ask her about? Water. She's probably not drinking enough water. Okay, so people struggle with water, right? You're like, okay, I need to drink 3 liters, right? That's like, what, 6, 7 of these in a day? Right? So what are strategies we can do for her?
Well, I struggled a lot with drinking water. I still do, but okay. I found what helped me was putting alarms in my phone.
Yeah.
Every, like, 15 minutes.
Yeah, man. What else?
Certainly.
Putting it in a bigger container so you can see as it goes down the day.
Okay.
You putting in, like, a 2-liter container or 1 liter, at least, and that way going 3 of them rather than 7. You lose track of how many you have when they're small.
Yeah. Small ones. Yeah, what else?
I use the tape method too on the water plants, water bottles.
Okay.
Where you put 9 a.m., 10 a.m., 11 a.m., and then they have to be at that number by the time hits, and on the back side it's like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
Okay, right. So different habits. What else can we do? Does everyone wake up?
Yes.
Everyone goes to sleep? Yes. Okay. A glass when you wake up, 8 ounces. A glass when you go to bed, 8 ounces. There's 16 ounces. Okay, so you gotta go half a liter. Now, most people eat 3 to 4 times a day. So if I have 8 before I eat, 8 after I eat, 8 before I eat, 8 after, 8 before, 8 after, I'm already at about 2.5 to 3 liters in my day. Right?
Mm-hmm.
That's just based off of meals, waking up and going to bed. If I do a workout now, and I throw another liter to 1.5 liters in there, my day, I'm now up around that 3 to 4 liter mark, depending on how big you are. You know, if you're smaller, you're going to be more than 2.5 to 3 liter mark. Right, if you're in like that 120 to 130 range for weight. Does that make sense? Right, so that's not even setting alarms. That's not taking a water bottle. Right? Oh, I'm going to eat. Probably drink a glass of water.
Most people don't eat regularly.
Right, but again, that they all, so again, that's just falling into the excuse that they don't eat regularly. Right, what are we trying to do? We're trying to remove excuses. Okay? Right, are we forcing people to do this? No, this is their choice. What are we doing? We're just educating them on how to do that. Right? So this is all your choice, and it's okay whether they do it or not. It doesn't bother me. Right? But when they want the result, and they keep doing the same thing, how can they expect anything else? And then they come blaming you, right, Chuck?
Yeah.
Not losing weight! Yeah? Drinks you have this weekend. Right?
The first thing I go to when someone says, I'm not losing weight, it's usually nutrition.
I want to lose 10 pounds, but they eat out every night and they drink wine every Friday, Saturday night with their girlfriends. and they don't want to get big. Just don't. Okay, well, so we talked about sleep, we talked about food with her, we talked about me time. What else? Talked about some water. Okay, so we established she's a CEO, she doesn't sleep very much. Right? We don't go into injuries or anything like that, but let's assume she's okay. What can she do? What she should be doing for some physical activity? Walking. Yeah. Okay, what kind of walking? Speed walking? Say again? I want her walking outside. I don't like gyms are cool, right? I want people to connect with nature. Get outside. How do you guys feel when you're in nature? Good. What happens when you got like fresh air on your face? Feel good, right? Now imagine if it was part of your day to take a 10-minute walk outside. Right? Can everyone walk for 10 minutes? Yeah. You just choose not to. Right? Do you feel better when you walk outside? I do. I feel fresh. If it's cold, guess what? You're gonna be awake. You know? Okay, so just getting this person to go for a walk in the morning is great. With my contest prep clients, they go for a walk as soon as they wake up. They don't go to the gym and do fasted cardio and they walk inside. Right? The treadmill is walking for you, correct? So what are you doing? Just picking up your feet. Right? If you're walking outside, what are you doing? You gotta move yourself. Right? Sprinting on a treadmill is very different than sprinting on a track. Trust me, I know the difference. Way different energy output. Okay? And she's connected with nature. What else can she do other than walking? Yoga. Yoga is great. Okay. And if she wants to work out intensely, maybe like 2 times a week, 3 times a week, and she's walking the rest. Right? Sometimes I get clients, you get people that their workout is their thing, like you work out for stress relief. Right? So sometimes you gotta break it down a little bit or change the program.
I took like a 6-day rest this week, for example.
A 6-day rest?
Yeah, I was just like, I can't.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You
could have
won.
I could have like walked or done something that sort of reduced my intensity in my workouts, for example.
Yeah, why did you cut it out?
My biceps were killing me.
Just too sore.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, you could have definitely done like something just less intense.
Yeah.
Yeah. Some walking, yoga, stretching.
I just do like,
Yes, mechanical stress, right? Like people are often cold after I do therapy on them because it's a nervous system response, right? It's normal. But unfortunately for me, in my business anyways, I release tissue that other people don't release. And so there is a level of pressure that has to be had, but your nervous system obviously reacts to that, right? But if you're more sensitive because you're not sleeping, you're not drinking water, you're not treating your body well, your pain threshold is going to be much lower than if your tissue is healthy and happy and hydrated. That's why some people are like, I need you to drink water for 3 weeks before I even touch you. Because I don't plan on just taking your money. I want you to feel better. Right? Okay. Sleep. Exercise. Me time. Food. What else? What did we ask? Yeah, family life can tie in with me time, that amortizes in stress. The other thing that I'll talk about is toxins. Medication she's on, birth control history, what do you clean your house with? What do you put on your skin? What do you ingest? Right? Do you have, oh my god, what are the name of those air fresheners? Glade, oh my god,
that's
like right, chemicals in the air that you're just breathing. Walk by someone with hairspray, I'm like, you know, like, right? You think about people that work in salons, a lot of them are sick. Right? They're around chemicals all the time, they're absorbing chemicals. Right? Chemical load, toxin load. Where did they grow up? Did they grow up on a farm? Did they grow up around chemicals? Right? These are all questions you want to ask. Okay? So you guys have like a pretty good like layout for your lifestyle? You guys have like the topics to cover. Okay, is a lot of it hard?
Possibly,
yeah. I mean, it's not hard. Right? What did I teach you guys today? If you were to sum it up,
lifestyle habits.
Lifestyle habits.
Yeah, I was gonna say lifestyle habits.
Yeah, it's all cheerleader like forceful side. Drink water. Like, you know, it's a 50% in, 50% out. You know, like this is a coaching relationship. I'm not here holding your hand. Okay. So what do you need to do then if your clients are like holding your client's hand?
I never do so.
Okay, good.
Maybe from the beginning. It's not, it may not be the easiest training done.
Yeah, so you know, so you guys are all gonna leave here today with some like extra knowledge. And there's gonna be people in your life, whether clients or friends or family, who don't want to listen to you. Right? Is that okay? Yes. Are you gonna get upset by it? You say no. We know that. You're gonna get frustrated and annoyed that people don't listen to you. Right? And you gotta let go of that. Right? You know what you know, you wanna take care of your health. And if someone wants your help, offer them your help, right? And then better yet, you know people, such as myself, you're like, hey, you should go talk to this guy, right? He does free consults, right? So it's just you guys save your own sanity because you don't have all the nitty-gritty, right? And you're working with friends and family, your friends and family, right? They're not going to listen to you, okay? So you just want to be aware of that. What else? Any other questions? Anything I didn't cover that you guys want to cover?
I wasn't sure what to expect. I was just wondering what we're going to talk about today.
Okay.
I've seen like some of the stuff that you've previewed before, obviously. But
yeah.
And I've talked about mine on the media time, obviously.
Yeah.
So I was kind of like expecting to hear what I heard today.
Okay.
It was kind of like a kick in my ass to be like, okay, you need to pay more attention to these things. Because
yeah.
I feel like I don't, even with my clients, need to pay more attention to this, the
yeah.
food intolerance side of things.
Yeah, so what we established today is that no matter what you have going on, it all comes down to lifestyle habits and for me to addressing the gut. Okay? When it comes to, you know, disease and health and vitality and feeling better, a lot of it comes from your gut. You are what you eat. You know, if we built this place out of cardboard, we wouldn't have a very good place. If you build your body out of junk food, coffee, and wine, you're not going to have a very good body or feel very good. You know, if you're constantly buying food out, you may not have a very good body either, depending on the quality of what it is you're purchasing. Subway is not health food. You know? Right? So it's all about, for me, I'm all about the more you make your food, the better. Right? Who here hates cooking?
I mean, it can be tedious, but I don't know what I
hate. Okay. How many people have friends that hate cooking? Yeah, right? Okay. So identifying what's going on with their cooking habits is important too. Right? Why they don't like cooking. Right? A lot of people, for me that I work with, they just don't cook because they don't know how to cook.
Yeah.
So, you know, especially you with clients, right? Maybe you take them to a cooking class.
Mm-hmm.
Like, hey, like, let's go to a cooking class. Maybe you hold a cooking class.
Host one.
Yeah, let's go cook. Well, you want your cooking class?
Yes.
Right? That means that. You know, people just don't know how to cook and make their food taste good. Therefore, is eating healthy going to be hard? Yeah, of course. Okay. All right. I'm going to turn this guy off.